are moving to the second part of today's conference, and the person who is already very anxious to speak is Mr. Morten LØKKEGAARD, the Vice Chair of the Education and Culture Committee. Thank you for being here, and you have 10 minutes on sharing your point of view. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, and you're certainly right. I'm eager because I happens to be the only MEP who's actually been here from the start and listening to all of the good interventions. A lot of things has been said already, so I would have liked to comment on it all. The time won't allow me to do that, so I'll try to be brief. Well, it's right that I am the Vice Chair in the Culture and Educational Committee of this Parliament, but I've only been in politics for 3 years. Actually, I've been a journalist for 25, so I have some, of course, experience in the topic we are talking about, also the term European journalism. And let me be frank, I think that this this lady over there, she's not there anymore, the Spanish lady, talking about you have to differ between these two things. I think she's perfectly right. I think it's absolutely right. I think journalism has a deep crisis, and it's a moral collapse. We can all look at the Murdoch scandal. It's a lack of business model. You can't survive anymore on the traditional business model. So of course, media press is under a certain pressure. Then we have the European problem, and that's why I'm here, basically, because when I ran for office, it was because of my background. I had some experience in just how big this gap that's already been described, how big this gap is between the audience, between the citizens, and the EU project as such, and the politicians involved in this. So that's why I went to Brussels to find out how to deal with this gap. And what I found out was, of course, that if one could create a European public sphere, that was a step, a first step, because we have no European public sphere. At least we hadn't, because I also agree with the gentleman over there who said that while we are talking and discussing, things are happening, actually. And that's for the better, because we are actually, what we've seen in the past year and a half, 2 years, is actually that we are, the circumstances create a European public sphere. And that's a very important point, because you can't structure your way out of this problem. You can't create Euronews. You did that 20 years ago. And then what happened? Nothing. Because you have to depend on the existing media, and you have to depend on the natural dynamics of media, of press. Press, of course, describes the reality, and that's what they do for a living. And if this reality is not worth describing, or you create institutions like my colleague Mr. Messerschmidt described, where you can't find your way out, well, there's nothing to describe. So what happens is now, because this parliament has been, because of the Lisbon Treaty, has gained some powers, the interest, of course, is beginning to grow among journalists. So it's a dynamic growth. You can't shape it, you can't create it like you tried with Euronews. So what to do? I mean, you have to take into consideration that you have to build on the existing press. You can't create new pan-European medias. Forget it. It's already been tried. So what you have to do is to do like Euranet is doing, building on existing structures, taking up the idea of partnerships between private and public sectors, and say, well, if we can pool our sources and create these networks, that maybe works. We still have to see, but I think it's a very, very good idea. So that's why it's so sad that the commissioner has closed down the idea of a TV equivalent to the Euronet. That's what happened last year, and gave the money to Euronews. I mean, that's a mistake, really. So we can talk, and I'm perfectly aware, I think my Polish colleague is absolutely right. I think the analysis is perfectly all right. But we talk and talk in this parliament, and we have to do more. We have to find out what is the real answers to this, take into consideration what is the real life out there, what is journalists actually struggling with, and then take bold decisions. And that's what we are in the phase of doing right now, pressing the commissioner to re-establish these projects and to come up with a real strategy on how to communicate. Not just talking about all the advantages of EU, but creating a real dialogue with the audience, with the citizens. And what is a real dialogue? That's a dialogue where you also talk about the cost of a non-euro, a non-EU. To take up these topics, these issues, which are actually as important as ever for the public, because they're not interested in listening to what we are doing in this parliament, because most of it is actually quite boring, seen from a public point of view. What they want to know is, what is the idea behind this project? What is the political project? What is the vision? Do we have to make a 2.0 vision of the old one? Yes, we have. And then we have to create a strategy in order to create this dialogue. And do it in networks like the Euronet. That is the solution. I could say a lot more, but I think I'll stop right here.
Thank you very much, Mr. LØKKEGAARD. The next look into a case study on investigative journalism will be introduced by Florence BELLONE from RTBF. Okay, hello. Whatever, yeah, the computer you mean? Or what? The microphone?
No, sorry.
For the radio? Yeah. I think you can.
Could we have some questions, please?
Aha, you mean the questions from the students?
Yeah.
Okay, so a lot has been said. I'm sure some of you already have some questions prepared, or even from earlier. Yes, Ms.? Mm-hmm. Well, you would like to answer your questions?
Well, I just forgot the whole part about the investigative journalism. I think maybe that since that's the topic we are discussing now, right, maybe I can get in about this.
Mm-hmm.
Is that
okay? Of course.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, yes. Then we have the whole discussion about how to support, and that is basically to finance quality journalism. And Brigitte Alfter has already mentioned it, that we are in connection with and in cooperation with the investigation environment, journalist environment. We are trying to come up with projects that can actually support, from the EU's point of view, this investigative journalism, cross-border investigative journalism. Since we now are facing a lot of cross-border problems within the EU, trafficking, crime, all sorts of crime, we have to have quality journalists following these matters. In the end, it's a matter about money. It's about resources, as it's already been said, the costs of traveling. I mean, many newspapers don't have the resources at the moment to do this kind of journalism. So what to do? What can we do? 2 years ago, we introduced a model which actually had the backing of this parliament. We had the budgets. We had the projects. But again, it was stopped for regulatory reasons by the Commission. We have fought for this project since then, and at this point in time, we have it for the third year in a row. We have it on the budget for this year, but now as a feasibility study on how to bring up a model which can finance these kind of projects. The problem is that the EU system as it is now will not allow a third body, an independent body, giving out money to projects so without controlling it. And then, of course, it's nonsense talking about independent journalism. So we have to find a model where we can actually pull out the check without asking any more questions, and have trust in the journalists running this. So this feasibility study we're now conducting is about how to find this model. And the interesting part of this is if we want to, as EU, want to support this kind of journalism, we have to come up with some kind of public support, some kind of public service model. Because, we, of course, we can't rely on the private sector to do this, and we should not, because we, as, it's perfectly all right, as my colleague Mr. Dickinson already been describing it, we should not intervene in this kind of I mean, it has no future, and the market will help to solve its own problem. But what we can do as an institution is to come up with some kind of public service model, on financing, and that's what we're trying to do, hopefully with the cooperation of the Commissioner, who seems to be a little reluctant so far.
Thank you very much. Is there a comment? I saw a hand being raised there. Do you have a comment regarding Mr. LØKKEGAARD's solutions?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that that investigation journalism in Poland, because I am from Radio Campus, from Warsaw, from Poland, is in very, very bad conditions. So talking about the investigative journalism in European Union in this time is extremely hard, at least from the angle of Poland. But the main point what I wanted to say is that I think, in my opinion, that's what I took from my experience in radio, is that there is quite huge lack of European identity above the European citizens. And this is quite, I agree with the previous statements that that there is a lack of European so-called citizenship consciousness. And that people, and that this system above the in European Union is very, very complex, and in many cases undemocratical, and people are completely lost, and many journalists as well are completely lost in this system. So it is very, very difficult to find anything in this system which could be taken as an interesting and taken to the surface. So I think this is the main problem, that we are trying to create some consciousness, but I think first we should change this some of the structures of European Union. I know that this is not the debate about this kind of issues, but I think this is very influencing as well on journalism, because at least in Poland, political system is quite complex, and many people are not interested in political issues. They are interested in some, you know, this kind of tabloids stories, but not in Europe, in a political system, in this kind of really political issues. So how they can be interested in European issues on this higher ground? This is
your question.
Very difficult. This is very difficult, and I think this is very strictly connected with European citizens' consciousness, and I think that's what we should think about to aware, and that's what I wanted to say on the final, that we shouldn't, in my opinion, we shouldn't do it by some so-called train ships, like Mr. Sariusz Wolski said before, or Erasmus for journalists, because they are already. They are in they are schools of journalists, European journalism schools, and they are prospering very well. So where is the problem? It's not the problem of educating people. It's the problem of the consciousness of the people, and we can't change that by changing the law. This is point of the process, you know. The consciousness of citizens' consciousness didn't arrive in nation states by like that, you know. This was the process of developing this, and this is not the point of law, that some Sariusz Wolski will say that, okay, we'll do this like this, and the European citizens' consciousness will arrive. That's what I wanted to say.
Okay, thank you very much for making a nice link there between the communication crisis we've heard a while ago and the investigative journalism. Ms. Florence Bellone, you will have an opportunity to introduce your radio report. And you obviously did a case study on investigative journalism.
Yes, and I hope that's going to help to rescue the image of radio journalism, because actually you can do absolutely anything in radio, exactly like in TV, I believe, or in written press with pictures. This subject... Okay. Thank you. The story, the aim of the investigation was about British social services. I am a press correspondent for the RTBF in the United Kingdom, so this is the reason I found a subject there. I tripped over this subject absolutely per chance from life, not dispatches. Just I think it's a thing journalists might pay attention if they want to make investigations that most of the subjects we never hear about or very little, you just find them opening the eyes, not really from other reports or from what is normally in the news. So I just put you in a little part to launch this. Sorry, I'm not good with...
That a newborn baby's health at risk.
Oh, come on!
Use your brain. Just stay calm. Don't argue with them, right?
They're
doing what they've been told to do, Julie.
You're stupid!
Well, no, they're not. They're doing what they're told to do. They're wrong, but they're doing what they've been told to do.
I'm afraid you can't take it, madam.
Oh,
don't.
Let's go with the child at the moment.
Fuck that! We'll go where we like. This is a free country.
Calm down. There's no need for that.
Look at this poor woman. Look at her. You stupid.
You want to take the baby off?
She was very much harmed before you came back.
You're a big man, aren't you?
Sir, at this time I'm arresting you for willful exposure of a child in the age of two, where his life may be in danger. You don't have to say anything, but it may harm the defence. Do not mention one question, something you later rely on in court, and you do say may be given evidence.
You're arresting me?
Yes, you're under
arrest. Why would that be?
We've just explained just why I said the offence. Okay, you're under arrest now. We're going to take you down to the van. Get you back to the police station.
Okay. Why pick you by me? Why are you arresting me?
Can I get some socks on, please? You want to put some clothes on?
Okay. Sorry. No, come on, let's...
Okay, so normally it is voiced over in French, of course, because it was for the French-speaking RTBF. This is a raid by the police, taking away a baby. The lady who you can hear crying tried 5 times to get a baby, because social services estimated that she won't be a good parent. They never left her a chance. In this occasion, she was hiding at the home of a couple of friends who know about law, who were hoping to sort out this issue, but nothing to do. Three policemen so come to take the newborn baby, it's about 8 days after he was born. I knew about this subject because I attended adoption meeting, and adoption is a subject which is interesting many people, many countries today, for personal reasons. So I was totally naive about this. And I realized that the United Kingdom is practicing actually forced adoption, meaning adoption without consent of parents. And half of the children, we speak about 10,000 children per year, and half of them are newborns, baby, taken away at birth, because they estimate that the parents, the couple, the mother, the father, or boss, or just one, won't be good parents enough. So that's typically the kind of subject. I won't say it has never been reported in the UK. It has been a few isolated reports. It's very difficult for the British journalists because of the gagging order, the prohibition of described cases. but it is happening. But I thought if we read superficially the news, because we are focused on politics, economy, the great subjects they want every day, I thought it was isolated mistakes. I didn't realize for long, for several years, it was a daily reality and a hidden drama in this country. One of the problems of investigative journalism generally, it's because there is a secrecy of some things. There is investigative journalism because there is some things they want to hide from the public. We all know about this when it is about secret services. Journalists have even a lot of debates about the data protection, or at the contrary, it is of public interest to show every data. When it's about war and terrorism, the subject is about obvious for everybody. When it is about civil cases, family law, the secrecy is exactly the same. But it is not questioned. It is actually very difficult to question, because the parents who really reveal their own names and their own cases basically are jailed. How to do this kind of story? I will say that the first important thing is to be able to be accepted by the sufferers of the problem. The parents, the families, they are extremely afraid, and I suppose that in every kind of inquiry you can find people like this who are not going to show up easily, because they are extremely afraid they are threatened to go to jail. By another hand, they would like journalists to speak about their problem, but of course, the first, I think, took me about 1 year to get my first parents in my microphone. Yet it was a couple who fled the United Kingdom to save their family, so that I had to travel actually in another country. I think it's very important to understand it's a very long-term work. You need a lot of patience. It's like if you try to approach a wild animal. You need to try and to try and to try. And here there is a huge economical problem, as we talked about economical crisis in journalism, is that it costs a lot of time, which you can translate by a lot of money. From the moment you have the intuition of the subject, to the moment you really understand it is existing, to the moment you can have the material and the people to interview, It can be months, especially when you are lonely as a correspondent, a bit alone in this part. Then you have, in this occasion, I could find politicians, I could search the parliament archives and to see every MP who had talked about this, who denounced something in the parliament. It was quite easy to have interviews with them, of course. Which is much more difficult is all the other part, the social services, the child protection responsible, the authorities, those basically systematically refused me all interviewed. I asked for, even bosses, people who are, who can have a speech, already speech for the public, they didn't want. So at some point, there is something that I could observe in the United Kingdom journalism, which is very, very strong for investigation, is that the only way of seeing what they want to hide you is to take a job or a task, which is allowing you to enter in this environment. In this occasion, there is a kind of task. The British call this Mackenzie Friend. It's a legal support, which is free. It's for people who can't anymore to have a solicitor. Any citizen has right to do this. It's from amateur, very basic level, to some who are almost professional. I mean, who knows the law as solicitor. And even sometimes charge a little money. So I took, of course, a very low level, and I took cases of parents who, let's say, it was no big hope of getting absolutely anything in family court. And this allowed me to attend assessments, parental assessments, by medical staff, social services, to go to family court to see what the judge was saying, doing, the kind of witnesses, and of course very important to access the confidential paperwork, because every paperwork from family court is basically, it's absolutely confidential. So you can't never understand what did really parents, if they did something wrong, why they are punished without crime. And also because it's a huge issue in democracy. I mean, everything which is secret about civil life. So I'm trying to see if I'm able to start a visual. I'm sorry. No. I want to go inside the main folder. Back.
Maybe when we are looking for the visual, you already found it.
I'm not sure I'm going to go ahead with the visuals because I have a huge. I'm actually not sure it's very easy for you to read. I can't even move it. Yeah. This is a typical gagging order. It's an injunction on reporting. A reporting injunction emitted by a British court can only be valid in the United Kingdom. However, they didn't have any trouble to send one to the RTBF in Brussels, which is just actually kind of intimidation, because they can't do absolutely nothing about what other countries report. So I wanted to show you how it is, but I think it's not very... It's not very easy, and if we are a bit short of time, I'm going to stay on sounds. So that's the main obstacle there. In every country, this is a British subject, but step by step, even if the situation is quite extreme in the United Kingdom, I had to realize that in every country in Europe and in the world is concerned about child protection. And problems with social services and abusive removal of children are existing about everywhere. The only thing that it's probably easier to defend themselves, so the parents can defend themselves more easily, because the press is able to report in most of the other countries. One example is Italy, where I realized, I didn't investigate because I'm not in Italy, but I saw many reports of the RAI, the national TV, and they have started to introduce forced adoption. But then you get the journalist bringing on TV the social services, the social workers, the psychiatric experts, the solicitors, the judge, the parents, the police, everybody, which is absolutely unthinkable in the UK. The common policy for every country is that because it's about children, they have not to be named, they have to stay anonymous, so that they won't be embarrassed and put under a particular pressure, which is normally some things for adults, like to be in court, in proceedings. Unfortunately, it's also what it is allowing the authorities to do absolutely what they want without being scrutinized at all. And what I'm going to make you hear now is there are children saying what they think about this. There are children who have been, the family has been in proceedings for 3 years with a happy end, because they actually, thanks to a very good solicitor, they were unable to take those children.
Mrs. Bellon, at this point,
yes.
Are you willing to get some questions from the students, perhaps?
If you want. Yes, uh-huh. Of course, I don't know.
Does anyone have anything in mind in particular regarding the case study? No? Anyone from the Euronet side? Okay.
What is it for me difficult to understand is how the social services in the UK actually choose the family where they want to pick up the children. And is there a politic line under this movement?
There are several ways of choosing the family. Of course, the humble people in the society, the poorest, especially all this population living now, because people don't live in the misery like before. They live with benefits, and they are extremely vulnerable to this, because they are already existing in the register of the social services. So otherwise you have for when it's about middle class, professional, more wealthy people, you have a lot of problems with the new illnesses affecting little children and babies. The last months we started to have a lot of problems with vitamin D deficiency. When women, pregnant women, have this deficiency, and when they breastfeed the baby also is going to have the deficiency. And one of the consequences is rickets, actually. And rickets also means broken bones. So the parents are going to go to the hospital because something's wrong with the baby, even if they can't really understand what. And then doing the x-rays, they see broken bones. And unfortunately, the first thing they do is to keep the baby, to put him into care, and to put the parents in proceedings saying, you have broken the baby. So then you have a legal fight, but it's, I mean, of course it can happen that criminal parents are going to break the baby. But I give you a very clear example, because there are so many stories like this in the United Kingdom. A doctor called Roy Meadow in the 90s decided, an expert, doctor and court expert, that when a woman is having two or three, so more than one, baby dying dead from what they call sudden infant cord death, it's a crime. Once it's an accident, twice it's likely to be a crime, three times it's a crime. They jailed a great number of ladies like this. And in 2005, I think, in Cambridge, scientists discovered the gene of this. So they opened the gene, everybody went out. Some two committed suicide. You can imagine what is, you have your life destroyed, you have lost two or three children, you can't have more, you have been accused to murder them. So, and this is continuing to happen with every kind of new pathologic problem we have today, because there are, every day there are new things, whatever is pollution or food, what you want. The vitamin D is absolutely not solved by doctors. They don't really know why such a huge part of the population, especially female population, is having this deficiency. That was
Florence, tell you. I would like to underline something, because this is interesting for you guys, because you want to be a journalist, and Could you describe how did you success to have a trust relations with the families? Because this is, it took time, and it was a very important step in your study and in your work, and it's, I guess, interesting for you all here in the room.
Yeah, I tried to pick up the very few cases I could get in the British media at the very beginning. But there are no names, no places. So you have to find out who they are. I have been helped with a few MPs who actually talked inside the parliament who don't have gagging order. So they put me on track, and sometimes they ask the people if they wanted to speak to me. In fact, very often they say, yes, it will be great. But once, for example, I went to Ireland the first time to find people on the run. And when I come there, I called for the appointment, and it was a lady crying, no, I'm sorry, I'm too afraid. It's my great daughter, it's my daughter, they are going to get us, I can't, I know you come, you traveled for this, but I can't. And you do this a number of time, and someday one is saying, okay. And later one person told me, enter Facebook groups, because actually you on social networks, you have a lot of groups, closed groups, generally, they try to be discreet, of people like this who have the same problem. And it's very important, I would say, to have a good behavior with these people. You need to take care of them. You cannot just treat them like a material for interview, because if you do this, the door is very quickly cut. So when you are settled in this environment and you go on groups and you chat with people, step by step, you get, today basically there is no one new case. I am not called. I don't have to look for. They come to me. So it's a lot of patience, but it's very rewarding also. Facebook, you know how invasive it can be. It means a rain of notifications in your email. But it's worth to take the pain, because this is real life, actually.
You say that you use a lot of new media and Facebook and social media. And this is an important point, I guess, because this is also a way to work and to get some information, to be in contact, to have a network of information. Did you also use, because I think it could be funny, some kind of spy techniques or kind of with microphone in your... pocket?
Yeah, microphones in my pocket all the time. Not really in my pockets, but not in tribunal, for example, because in tribunal you go through a security system which is about the same than in an airport, and they find even, a gadget like this, which is actually a camera or microphone, they find it. So you'd better don't do this, because you can also... damage the parents, because the parents in this situation are always responsible, so you don't want to. Now, when I go for a parental assessment with pregnant women, generally that happens in the flat or the house of the mom, so I come first and I put microphones, yes, things like this. Very beyond this, because of course it's radio, so if it was TV it would be a hidden camera. Beyond this, the technology, I honestly don't think the technology is the eye spying technology is the most important things for investigation. Right now in the United Kingdom we have a very important inquiry after the end of news of the world. You all heard about the end of the tabloid news of the world, because they were hacking people. We know they were hacking people, and Murdoch is hacking people for several decades, and it never disturbed anybody. Anybody, even in the public. It started to disturb people, and it started to be a scandal when they went too far. and really damage innocent people. Like, for example, they would hack the parents of a girl who has been murdered just to have, you know, in case they could find the parents who are murderers. So. Generally speaking, you know that tabloids are spying a lot of showbiz stars or personalities. There are all kind of technology. And I think in the last resort, the public is accepting investigative journalism not through which kind of technology, which kind of spying they use, but for which reason and which news are they going to bring. If you bring the news that social services might attack your family and take your children, even if you never armed them, I mean, people doesn't care how you did get this. If it's just to know that you ground the actor, he had a baby, and oh, we can say who is the mother, you know, it's, of course, there is a privacy invasion which looks a little bit for profit, I suppose, but...
At this point, well, Mrs. Bellone, thank you very much for this very in-depth intro to your case study. I would like to ask the remaining students, at least, you are actually here to learn on journalism. You are students of journalism. And here you had one example of an investigative journalism. Is there something that still bothers you? Do you have, I don't know, pros and contras regarding investigative journalism? What are your comments on that? Did you pay attention to the case study?
Yeah, I would like to know if it is easy to have the support of the media to do this kind of job.
Excuse me, I just couldn't hear.
If it is easy to have the support of the media to do this kind of research.
Oh, that's a very good question. I had the support of the RTBF. Obviously, because it's now about 2 years that I can make several reports and even continuing my investigation, because there are many, many angles, especially about the profit, the money of forced adoption. I have proposed this subject to many medias in France, as I am doing French speaking, and nobody wanted it. So there are two reasons for this. We are in Europe. Okay, if this subject is coming from China or Iran, or everybody say, oh, yes, of course. If it is coming from the patrie of the human rights, the United Kingdom, everybody say, you show you know. So that's already a big problem in Europe, because we are supposed to be democracy. And actually, if you search, if you dig, I mean, democracy sometimes, it's United Kingdom, it could be France, it could be Belgium, it could be any country. They have some little similarity with authoritarian regimes. And they are much more barricaded against journalism invasion than even can be a country like China, where it's absolutely almost normal that journalism are investigative because they have no choice. So that's one thing. The other thing is, I suspect, I felt a lot of, this kind of subject, you are touching the establishment. And I think some medias try to avoid this.